Times of trouble. Hi, good evening, everyone. We warmly welcome you and thank you for tuning in to the online English service of the Church of the Good Samaritan in Kota Kinabalu. Our call to worship today is from Psalm 34, verse 8. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in Him. We praise God that once again, He has called us to gather together as His chosen people to worship Him. Our prayer is that you and your loved ones will have a fresh encounter with Him today. May you experience a supernatural breakthrough in every area of your lives, and may you be filled afresh with the joy of the Holy Spirit. So come, taste, and see that the Lord is good. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
I was glad when they said unto me,
Let us go to the house of the Lord.
Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord.
Let us shout for joy to the Almighty Savior.
God is spirit.
We must worship Him in spirit and in truth.
Glory to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Praise the Lord, now and forever. Amen.
Let us declare Psalm 91 together. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. If you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord who is my refuge, no harm will befall you, no disaster will come near your tent. Because He loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call on me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Brothers and sisters in Christ, as we come before our God today, let us give him our highest worship.
Throne of God, praises the highway. Testament lessons is taken in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 27, verse 1 to 10. Moses and the elders of Israel commanded the people, "Keep all these commands that I give you today. When you cross the Jordan into the land the Lord your God is giving you, set up some large stones and coat them with plaster. Write on them all the words of this law when you have crossed over to enter the land the Lord your God is giving you, a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord the God of your father promised you. When you cross the Jordan, set up the stones on Mount Ebal, as I commanded you today, and coat them with plaster. Build there an altar to the Lord your God, an altar of stones. Do not use any iron tools upon them. Build the altar of the Lord your God with few stones and of burnt offering unto the Lord your God. Sacrifice fellowship offering there, eating them and rejoicing in the presence of the Lord your God. And you shall write this very clearly, all the words of this law, on these stones you have set up." Then Moses and the priests who were Levites said to all Israel, "Be silent, O Israel, and listen. You have now become the people of the Lord your God. Obey the Lord your God and follow his commands and decrees that I give you today. This is the word of the Lord."
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this wonderful time. Lord, we ask for your guidance from the Holy Spirit upon the word of God. Help us not just to understand, but receive and also to apply your word. Bless the elders to the youngest. Lord, we just commit this time into your hand. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now we are moving to the last sections of this book, the book of Deuteronomy, where this is the historical day where we see the covenant about to be sealed between God and the people. God is not giving them the new one, but to give them a covenant and require them to commit, to place a commitment upon the covenant, which the Lord say, if you keep the covenant, then they will be blessed. Okay? So if we talk about covenants, we need to trace back a little bit from Abraham. From Abraham, that the Lord has sealed that covenant with him, that had saying that God will make him to be a great nation. Then from there on, he moved to Isaac, Isaac to Jacob, Jacob of course to Joseph, and one of his sons. Joseph was sold to Egypt. Then wrong things happened. Because Joseph was used by the Lord, even though a lot of things happened to him, God used him and gave this saving plan, how the whole family, the whole household of family, Israel was saved. But they moved down to Egypt. Okay? So from Egypt, then 400 years they were slaves to the Egyptian. Then God sent Moses and bring them up from Egypt, the Exodus, where God has set the Ten Commandments to them in Mount Sinai. Okay, from there on, they move on. They are about to enter in the Promised Land, but then they rebel and not cast unbelief. Because of that, God sent them 40 years into the wilderness. From the older generations, only Joseph and Caleb were able to enter to the Promised Land. The rest just died in the wilderness. Then the newer generation, where the book of Deuteronomy is come about, Moses preached three sermons to them. We have heard the first one about what God has done from chapter 1 to chapter 4. Then the second sermon, I would say, from chapter 5 to chapter 26, all about God's laws and regulations. And then now, in the last sermon that Moses preached to the people is from chapter 27 to chapter 31, is about God's covenant. It was in this section that we see that covenants will be sealed with the two between God and the people, and giving them how many or how much privileges they can receive by keeping the word or the covenant. And God, of course, from chapter 27, later on you see chapter 28, 29, when you obey, then you will be blessed. When you disobey, there will be curses. Alright? So this is what happened in the plan of Moab. They received this solemn commitment for the second time. And they would confirm it a third time when they enter in the promised land, which recorded in Joshua chapter 8. Okay, so this is what happened, where Moses is told to write out the agreement and also to hold a special festival or ceremony, I would say, at which offering is presented to the Lord and of the covenant. And it is to require the Israelite to make a decisive commitment. So this is a covenant. This covenant is supposed to be a good one, this is a really good covenant, because the covenant was set and a seal between God and the people. We must know, in doing covenant, there will be privileges. The privilege that are only given to either party A or B. Like for instance, I have a privilege to seal the marriage covenant with my wife. Okay? I have a privilege to seal the covenant where I enter into full time to be ordained as a priest. I think you will have the privilege to enjoy where you have the covenant between you and your business or with your client, especially the big company, because that privileges only can be enjoyed by who? By you alone, not others. Okay? So this covenant, inside this covenant, by keeping the word of God, we should have enjoy the privileges and also all the benefit from this covenant. That's why covenant is not so much like really to restrict or bound us, but one of the major requirements is that within this covenant we should be we should obey, and also we shouldn't have seal another covenant with others. That is bad. The Hakka say, no, leong tiu saba. You cannot have a like a two-head snake, whereby sometimes you obey this one, at the same time you obey another one. God do not want us to be like leong tiu sa, the two-head snakes, but then you God want us to be faithful to Him. Just by the faithfulness and also the obedience to this one covenant, we will have enjoyed every privileges from the Lord, namely all the blessings from the Lord. Amen. So this is what we're going to look at today. What are the privileges, and how are we going to enjoy all this? By keeping the word, or I will say the covenant. Amen. First, we want to look at from chapter 27, Deuteronomy chapter 27, verse 1 to verse 4, about a clear written word. Moses and the elders of the Israelite commanded the people, keep all these commands that I give you today. When you have crossed the Jordan into the land of the Lord your God is giving you, set up large stones and coat them with plaster. Write on them all the words of the law when you have crossed over, enter the land the Lord your God is giving you, a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your fathers, promised you. And when you have crossed the Jordan, set up the stones on Mount Ebal, as I command you today, and coat them with plaster, a large stone. This is a stone that they should go to set up, not cutting, just one piece, and then all the writing on it is supposed to be clear. With the plaster, you see, the writing will be clearer. This is how you probably in our modern text, we will say, you know, to highlight it, so that it will serve as a reminder and a serve to I will say it's like the those of us in the school, we have Rukun Negara, everything is on the wall, that every time you enter the school, either the slogan or what have we got on the crest, always is big and clear, and sometimes at the gate, sometimes on the wall, sometimes as a banner, okay, to remind the students every day when they walk in. Today we're supposed to have that to remind us again and again through our modern method, like through televisions, some of the advertisements, and this we need to build our generation up when they are still in the school, and so that they again and again be reminded this is our lifestyle as a Malaysian. How about the Israelite? They need this. Yeah, you know, the Israelite sometimes they will have this short memory disease, sickness. Eh? They can forget things like on the next day. One incident in the during Moses and Aaron, their plague disaster hit them. The next day, the Bible says, the next day they come and rebel the Lord again. No, short memory disease. So again and again, you see from the Bible, God need to use different ways to remind them. And this is the time where my God set, I would say, the officially the second time, but technically probably the third time, how His commandments was crafted on the first one was on the tablet, now and the large stone. Okay, so this is very special, and the stone, you cannot cut it, it must come from one. Why? Because like in the Greek culture, the word sincere, coming from the Greek word is sincera, where this is the practice, you need to offer something, and also which is valuable, especially to God, that stone need to be one as original. So in Greek, now you will see some of the statue, those are coming really from the one stone, without any add-on or crack. You will see from the bottom that the word sincera. Okay, so this is something the Lord wants. Eh? As we see, the word of the Lord was clearly written to the people. Deuteronomy chapter 27 verse 8, and you shall write very clearly all the word of this law or this stone you have set up, you see? Not just clear, but very clearly. Deuteronomy chapter 7 verse 12, you will pay attention to this law and careful to follow them. Then your Lord, your God, will keep His covenant of love with you as He swore to your forefathers. How clear is the written words of God to you and to me today? Sometimes, we will make a lot of excuse saying that probably the Bible too small, or we do not have the Bible, or this is last time. Now we see Bible is just on our handphone, Bible is just on the tablet, Bible is everywhere. You have the large print Bible, you have the very what we call different versions kind of Bible. It's made available online, you can just click on it, and all of the websites you can get the Bible verse. It was not like last time. No, we hear story like people need to wait for missionaries to smuggle the Bible to them, take the Bible to them, and then they go to copy it one by one. Eh? And it's not by Bible, it's by chapter, or probably sometimes by verses. So one time the missionary came, they will bring the chapter to them, they got to write it, copy, and then pass it to others. But now we see nations like that, they had the larger Bible publisher in the world. So amazing. So today we shouldn't have any excuse anymore. that we do not have this clear written word of God. But what is the problem? With the last stone, with the very clearly written word, but yet you don't see people really follow or really obey or keep or pay attention to it. Why? Problem with the heart. Always the heart of the problem, always the problem with the heart. So in New Testament, you see from Matthew chapter 22, verse 37 to verse 40, Jesus summarized everything. He said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first greatest commandment. And the second is like this. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and prophets hang on to these two commandments. Very clearly, love God and love people, both vertical and horizontal. It's that simple. But what problem? Always a problem with the heart. That's why Jesus say, the word is not written on the tablet. It's supposed to be written on your heart, in my heart, in all the people's hearts, so that we can really pay attention and keep His commandments. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 2 to verse 3. You yourself are our letter, written on our heart, known and read by everyone. You know that you are a letter from Christ, the result of our ministry, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not on the tablets of stone, but on the tablet of human heart. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 10. This is a covenant I will make with the house of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my laws in their minds and write them together on their heart. Or we change it, is the law will be written on our heart. I will be their God and they will be my people. From this covenant, basically God wants to remind us He is our God. He cares, He's love, He provides, He protects, He will do everything for His people as long as we keep His commandments, we keep His word, we keep the covenant. And in the New Testament, you see, with the Spirit of God, what Jesus said is that the word is supposed to be written and crafted on our heart. With this, if we put the word of God here in our hearts, we will pay attention, we will keep, we will obey, we will follow, we will live according to the word. With that, you will see blessing will come. Amen. So how clear is the written word of God to you? Second, we want to look at another point about an altar of sacrifice. You know, from this, if you look at chapter 27, the commandment, the instructions were given in verse 12 as well. When you cross the Jordan, this tribe shall stand on Mount Gerizim and also Mount Ebal. So this is some of the, what we call a ceremony of reaffirming the covenant. It will take place near Shechem. Okay? On the north of Shechem, there is the Mount Ebal, which on the north is signifying curses. And Mount Gerizim on the south of Shechem, then you see it signifies blessing. So with these six tribes who are going to stand on Mount Gerizim, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, Joseph, and Benjamin. And the tribe that shall stand on Mount Ebal to pronounce the curses is Reuben, Gad, Asher, Zebulun, Dan, and also Naphtali. So in this valley, it's very appropriate where the Levite, the priest, will kind of have this ceremony and also to pronounce the covenant. And God required this from verse 5 to verse 7. Build there an altar to the Lord your God, an altar of stones. Do not use any iron tool upon them. Build the altar to the Lord your God with fires, with few stones, and offer a burnt offering on it to the Lord your God. Sacrifice fellowship offering there eating them and rejoicing in the presence of the Lord your God. Two offerings, burnt offering and also fellowship offering, is the confessions of sin. In Romans also saying that the knowledge of the words of the law is sin, because law help us to know our situation, our sinful nature, and said we need to confess. And the burnt offering also to signify the our commitment to the law. As we repent, that how we move toward the law. And also the fellowship offering, you see this originally, it also called the shed offering, that you the offering supposed to be shed among the donor, the Levites, the priests, and other people. Right? So this is the symbolic act of worship, where it's not just to reaffirm our commitment to the Lord, but also at the same time to really put our allegiance to Him alone, to see where the sacrifice has been done. Then we will declare that our God is the only true God, the only God that we will worship. We will not worship other gods. So with this, you see, from these sacrifices, there's a kind of spiritual elements, especially if you look at the tabernacle or the temple. They always the burnt offering. After the burnt offering at the outer court, then they will move on to the bronze blazing of bronze. It made by bronze. When you go there to wash, the bronze will reflect on yourself. That is to reflect on whether still the sinful nature or anything that inside of with this we reflect the reflections. We see, oh, okay, this is me. Either we are clean or we still have something that hold on to the sinful nature. So Psalms 119 verse 9 say, how can a young man keep his way pure? By living according to your words. Amen. Romans chapter 3 verse 20, therefore no one will be declared righteous in his sight by observing the law. Rather, through the law we become conscious of sins. Okay? So this is the effect or the influence by the law of God. We will not just because of become righteous by observing it, but through this we know about our situation, through the laws. And James chapter 1 verse 22 to verse 25, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourself. Do what is said. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what is said is like a man who looks at his face in a mirror, and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forget what he looks like. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continue to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, by doing it he will be blessed in what he does. Amen. Okay, so this is something like a cleansing, a washing process. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 12, for the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to the dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thought and the attitude of the heart. That's why we offer the sacrifice to the Lord, as we know our situation by keeping and knowing the law. And 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 16 to verse 17, all scripture is God's breath and it is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting and training in righteousness, so that together the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Amen. So this altar of sacrifice is truly a ceremony to reaffirm our commitment to the covenant. Okay? So by doing so, you see people are moving forward, they are progressing into a holy nation. Amen. Alright? So this is something that we should do. But not just reading the Word of God. I know some of you have been doing well on the Bible reading. I encourage you to do so. Continue to do so. So apart from doing the daily devotion, we also have our own devotional material, and also doing the Bible reading every day. If we can do that, and applies the act of worship, our dedications to the Lord, you will see your life will never be the same again. Amen. Last, we want to see another point about a response of obedience. Deuteronomy chapter 27, verse 9 to verse 10. Then Moses and the priests who are Levites say to all the Israelites, be silent, O Israel, and listen. You have now become the people of the Lord your God. Obey the Lord your God and follow his commands and decrees that I give you today. What kind of response? Why we need to respond? Why we need to commit? Why we need to obey the word of God? Why cannot always answer to read the Bible, read the Bible, read the Bible, read the Bible? Can I not reading the Bible? Or I read the Bible 30 years ago. Why I still need to read the Bible again? Why I need to pay attention to the word of God again? Simply because, like what Moses said, now you have become the people of the Lord your God. As a people of God, as a children of God, there's some requirement of how we should respond in obedience to the word of God. Okay? Just like in the house, you have certain rules as a children or as a residence in the house, you need to follow the rules. Okay? In Chinese proverbs, it says, in the nations that the laws, in the house you also have the laws. In school also you have the laws. In your company also you have the laws. Why I need to observe the regulations of my company, of the church, of my house, or of my country? Why? Simply because we are the people of that parties. If we are workers and employees of this company, I need to observe the law. Certain employers have their different regulations to run their company. As long as I am one of those, I was employed by the company, I need to follow. As long as we are the children of God, a people of God, we need to respond in obedience to the word of God. Amen. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8. Do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Eh? Not just occasionally. It's meditating it day and night that will help us. If we can follow and pay attention and keep all the commandments of the Lord, you will see as we respond in such a way with the that the level of obedience, the full obedience to the word of God, you will see the life will be prosper. Not prosper in terms of wealth, in the material wealth, but we will be prosper. Or the original word will be, you know, doing things whereby things will be smooth. Eh? You will see the wisdom, you will see the guidance, how we will find a way to do things and to live our life, simply because of meditating the word of God day and night. Amen. And last, Matthew chapter 7 verse 24 to verse 27. Therefore everyone who hear this word of mine and put them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the wind blew and beat against the house, yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears this word of mine and does not put them into practice, it's like a foolish man who built his house on sand. If the rain came down, the stream rose, and the wind blew and beat against the house, and it fell with a great crash. It's a sad thing whereby today we are given the privileges of keeping the law. Not everyone will have that privilege to keep the word of God, the Lord of Lords, the Kings of Kings, the Almighty God, the one who created this universe, the Creator. And with this word that was clearly written to us today and put it into what we call our Bible, how much time that we truly read and obey and pay attention to the Word of God. Only by that, if we can do that, then we will see our own situation by offer a so-called spiritual sacrifice to the Lord as we dedicate ourselves to the Lord and let that process of cleansing and washing to us. It is very important, brother and sister in Christ, only when we respond with obedience that we will keep this law, then you will see blessing will come. Because later on you see the response of the people is not just by handful of them or majority of them, but in chapter 27 verse 16 onward, every time when they announce the proclamation about, well, here is about curses, then all the people shall say amen. They agree every time proclamation been done, then all the people shall say amen. And this is how we respond to the Word of God. Amen. I want to encourage all of us to really put more effort into keeping the Word of God, because by doing so, you see, next week onward we will look at chapter 28 about those who obey the Word of God, it will be blessed. Those who disobey the Word of God, clearly it will be cursed. So this is the covenant that by keeping the Word of God, you see the privileges behind where we will enjoy and to be blessed by the Lord. Would you like to have that kind of privilege? Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We pray that you will continue to bless us and guide us so that from listening and paying attention and keeping and observing and obeying the Word of God, meditating, Lord, we pray that your blessing will flow to us, O Lord. Help us to live according to your word. We commit the rest of the time into your head. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Ancient words will guide us all. Ancient. Let's pray. Father God, we praise and give thanks for the promise that you repay all people according to what they have done. We also want to pray for the church. We pray that through the Love Your Neighbor project that we will experience your blessing as we joyfully and willingly reach out to our neighbors. Pray that more will do it, and we pray more will have your heart and your love to do it as well. We also want to pray for the Sunday school teachers from all three congregations as they meet to plan and prepare for Christmas. We pray for your creativity upon them, and we pray that many non-believing children will join the celebration and hear the gospel. We also want to pray for the diocese. We pray for all the clergies and pastors as they meet weekly to pray for the diocese and their own ministry needs. We pray that you speak to them on what you want to do in the church. We also want to pray for the nation. We pray that the government will show love and concern to all citizens, regardless of race or religion during this pandemic. We also pray for wisdom upon the government in what to do as well. And as for Sabah, we pray against the rise of the third wave of the COVID-19 cases. We pray that the state government will help those in need, especially with the extension of the CMCO. And we pray for protection over the people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us now pray as our Savior taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Do not bring us to the time of trial, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Let's all receive the blessing of the Lord. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your heart and mind in the knowledge and the love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. My brother and sister in Christ, go in peace and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you. Lord.